Man, it's good to see you guys today. Maybe y'all wondering why am I up here. Pastor took my spot on the announcement, so I get to preach today. How about that? Man, it is good to see you guys. I hope you are ready, and I hope you are have your ears open and your hearts open for what God is wanting to tell you and speak through you today, because I believe God is going to speak to a lot of us, and it is going to be a very, very awesome day. Before I get started, though, I just want to give a shout-out. Thank you, Pastor Wade and Andrea, for your leadership and giving me this opportunity to come up here and speak. It's always, always an honor. So thank you so much. Church, honestly, we have the greatest leader here in Illinois, don't we? Incredible. Thank you so much. They do a fantastic job. Fantastic job. So thank you so much. It's truly a blessing. So if you don't know me, maybe you don't know me, not a whole lot about me. Some of you might know too much about me. I am Zac Sunderland. I'm the youth pastor, student pastor here at Marengo First Assembly. Incredibly awesome time here. It really is. I love what's going on Wednesday nights at Frontline Student Ministries, and I encourage you, parents, if you have an opportunity on a Wednesday night, maybe you're free, you got nothing going on, come out and check us out. I'm not going to restrict it and say, hey, you're a parent, you can't come in here, this is just kids only. You can come out and check out what's going on anytime on a Wednesday night, or even Sunday morning down in the core for our Sunday school. So it's truly an honor to be here at Marengo First and doing what God has called us to do. My wife Taylor's in the back. Wave your hand. Come on, wave your hand. There she is. My beautiful wife Taylor back there, her and I are doing this together, and it is a fantastic time. It has truly been awesome. Been here almost 3 years, coming up in August, so we're pumped, and it's super exciting what God's going to do the rest of this year and for years to come. So if you brought your Bible, we're going to get started here. I encourage you to turn to Genesis. We'll be in the last chapter, chapter 50 of that book, and we'll get back to the scripture here in a little bit. Before I get started, let me pray. Father God, I thank you for this beautiful day you've given us, Lord. And I pray for every person in this room, God, Lord, from the youngest to oldest, that you just have your way with us, Father. Have your words with us, Lord Jesus. And help us not to be shut off by anything that gets said today, but to be so accepting and so open to what you are wanting to speak to us, not me, Father God. And I pray that you just use me, God, as a vessel, Lord, to be your words, God, your thoughts and your passion just flowing in and out through me today, Jesus. I give you all the praise, Lord, for what you're going to do today. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Like I said, it's good to be here, but let me get started here. I believe everyone in here, has different preferences when it comes to the temperature in your house, right? Apartment, house, wherever you live, room, dorm room if you're in college. I believe everybody's got a different preference for that. There is always, I believe everybody can agree with me on this. Always somebody that you live with that has complete control over the thermostat in your house, right? Don't point any fingers. I see a bunch of fingers, faces, weird faces getting made. But I really believe that's true. And for the person that is always not in control of that, I mean, they either got to deal with it, they got to live with it, they got to suck it up and just say, okay, I'll be okay, I guess. I ain't got no say over what goes on here in the house. So, especially the temperature, so we're just gonna go with how it feels here in the room, okay? Anybody like that? I know, yeah. What, you gotta wave your hand for, was that me? Come on. That was my wife, by the way. But for that one person that have the room exactly where they want it, exactly how they like it, it's gotta be perfect. Perfect in every way. And like I said, everyone else has gotta suffer or they gotta deal with it. I remember growing up as a kid, man, it was pretty brutal. And I think if you had kids that are older now, they'll probably say the same thing, which they're probably lying. I am, you know, probably not telling the truth. It wasn't that bad, to be honest with you. But I thought it was. Growing up as a kid, I remember my mom, she would not turn on the one AC unit we had for a two-story house till the middle of July. Middle of July. And I think a lot of you know middle of July, what the heat is like. In July, and if you're in the house, especially a two-story house with one AC unit, it's stinking hot. It is hotter than hot. It's hotter than a stinking sauna, and you're sweating to death. It is hot. It is sticky. All right, who knows what it's like going to bed in super hot, hot degree weather with no fan, no AC, no nothing going on. I see a couple of hands. You know exactly what I'm talking about. It's nasty, man. You try rolling over, and everything. Everything sticks to you. It's like almost a mattress comes up on top of you as well when you roll over. That's how bad it was, okay? You might say, maybe this guy's exaggerating. I am not exaggerating. Talk to my siblings. They will tell you the same thing. No breeze And every night, no breeze would come in the window at all. It's like, Lord Jesus, take me home or something tonight, please. Please help me out with this or something. I can't do this anymore. But I remember going up, and it would not change. We would have no words that would persuade her, that would change her to do anything else, that would make her feel, I'm gonna show some grace and love and mercy for my kids today. I'm going to turn the AC on. Nope. It is not July yet, and it was not going to be turned on. So I know what it was like having somebody who was completely in control of the thermostat or just the whole AC in general, and it was just not, it wasn't happening. There was nothing we could do, and it was super hot. But let me give you a better illustration of what I'm going to talk to you guys about today. I have a friend who once told me about an assignment that he had growing up. And when he went to college, his psychology teacher had him and the rest of the students in this class do this for the remainder of the year, for the duration of the year. So this was the first day, and she wanted them to observe, all right, the effect that the temperature of the house, the dorm, the apartment, wherever they were staying at, had on the people who lived with them in that time. Sounds like fun, right? Sounds like pretty, like I want to do that when I go home today. See how that works. I'll probably get hit or something. Probably get smacked in the face. But anyway, more specifically, how it affected their mood or their behavior. How it really just got under their skin and just messed with them. And they just wanted to freak out on everybody they saw. So throughout the year, he would mess with everybody. And he was in a dorm, so the thermostat, luckily, was on his side of the room. So he had the perfect opportunity, perfect chance to mess with his roommate. So in the summer, obviously he would turn the heat up slowly. You can't do it very fast, or they would know. You gotta do it slowly. He would turn it up, and the guy would just start sweating like crazy. He tried to do his homework, and then he'd make a mess up on a problem or something, and something just freaks him out, and he just gets so angry. Anybody know what it's like when you're hot, and you can't, it's just too hot, and you get so frustrated, and you get angry at everything, at the air moving. You can't breathe right? It's hard to breathe. So he would keep turning it up and bring the worst out of his roommate. The moment something went wrong, he would just spaz out and freak out on everybody. Then in the winter, he would start turning it down more and more and more. Keep going down, and he would just have so much fun with this. He was just laughing the whole time, just telling me the story. Turning it down until it got colder and colder, and this guy was bundled up like an Eskimo. All you could see was his eyes poking out of the blankets and the coats and everything. And you're probably like, well, why didn't he just go turn the thermostat up himself? I'll get back to that in a little bit. But he wouldn't say much of anything. You remember being cold? It's cold outside. I am not a fan of the cold. I'm ready for summer. Anybody said amen? Come on. Somebody, a couple of you out there. All right. But you know what it's like being cold. You can't move. If you're so out in the cold weather, it's hard to move at all. You try to stay warm just by shivering and getting next close to somebody. And then you have that one friend who comes out in shorts and a t-shirt when it's like 20 degrees outside, and you just look at him, and you just want to smack him in the face. But you can't because it's so cold. You know what I'm talking about? I think we all have that one friend. You know exactly what I'm talking about. But what he found out by doing this whole experiment, the climate around us affects us in a very significant way. Whether we notice it or whether we don't notice it, it affects us in a big, in a significant way. Everywhere we go, everywhere you go has a climate. It has a climate, not just an actual temperature that can go up and down, but it's got a mood. It's got a feeling. It's got an atmosphere. It's got a climate everywhere that we go. And get this, we all, every one of us, have the power to change that climate wherever we are, wherever we go. We have the power to change that climate. We all have been in a situation, I believe, where someone came in and just changed the climate in the room you were at in that moment. Give you a couple examples here. Maybe when you were a kid, go back to your kid ages, your kid years, back when you were little, maybe you had some friends over. Just give you a kind of a funny example here. You had friends over, they were having fun, you were just having fun playing, the mood was great, just having a good time. And then maybe your dad decides to walk down, not knowing you had friends over, and he's doing his own thing. And he walks down the stairs in his boxers and a t-shirt that was just way too small for him. Come on. Somebody's got to have that experience before. I see a hand. Yes. All right. Yes. And it went from really, really fun to extremely just awkward. Like, what do? Cover their eyes? Or you freak out on your dad? Or you just walk out of the house? Or maybe you're at work Maybe you're working, everyone is working hard, man. They are getting stuff done. It is a good day. Stuff is getting done around here in this workplace, and you are excited, and everybody else is excited. Nobody's in a bad mood until your boss walks into the room, and maybe he's having a cranky day. Maybe he's just on, maybe he's just not having a good day. He starts yelling at everybody, saying, "You're not doing that right. Why aren't you getting stuff done?" And then everybody's like, "Bro, we're getting stuff done. Come on, man." And you just yelling, just throwing out mean words, just not building everybody up, not making it a good work environment. Maybe you've been a part of that. And it goes from, the climate goes from productive to very stressful in seconds. Or maybe you're at home. Maybe you've had a day off and you're home and the kids are off at school. You get 8 hours or so to be by yourself and do whatever you want. You can read a book. You can go wherever you want. You take a nap. Like, naps are awesome, right? I'm going to take a nap today. Thank you, Jesus. Naps are awesome. But you can take a nap. You do whatever. And then 3 o'clock, 3:30 hits. And you know what time that is? The bus rolls up. You hear the brakes squeak. And then the kids come home. They come inside. And then the climate turns from a very peaceful and joyful moment to, well, a house full of kids, right? I think a lot of you know what I'm talking about. But sometimes, but fortunately, I believe every one of us know at least one person that can make the climate better. I think we know somebody who can make the climate that we're in just completely better than what it was when we walked in on it. But I think most of us like to think that that person could be us a lot of the time. I think a lot of us like to think, well, that's me. I can make the climate way better than what it is. Oh yeah, come on. It's going to be good. It's going to be fun. But that's not always the case. If you really stop and think about that. Sometimes we let circumstances determine the climate we're in. Or we let other people determine the climate for us. We get around somebody who's got a big impact, a big influence on our life, and we start conforming to what's going on in their life, their circumstances. We conform to that, and we take part of that. When we let our circumstances determine the climate we're in, instead of changing it, we start to conform to it. But as Christ followers, as we proclaim to be followers of Christ, we have the power to change that climate that we've either walked into or has got brought upon us. We have the power to do that. Right. You have the power to change your bad circumstances into opportunities to show light of Christ around the people you work with, around the people you talk to, around the people you see every day. You have that opportunity to do that. And when you allow God access and full control of your life right now, when you do that, he will give you the power to change climate. If you're wondering what my title today is, the message, it is Change Climate. I encourage you to write that down if you're taking notes. If you're not taking notes, if somebody's not taking notes next to you, rip off a piece of paper or something, give you a bulletin, tell them to take notes. Change climate. I want to show you a great example, really good example from the Bible, someone who brings a climate change to a stressful situation. A lot of you might know the story of this guy. This guy's name is Joseph. I love the story of Joseph. And like I said in the beginning, if you got your Bibles with you, I encourage you to Genesis chapter 50. We'll be there in just a minute. Now, from our perspective, though, if we take a look at Joseph's life, we read through the Bible in that chapter and we see the whole story of Joseph, we would think he had a pretty crazy, whacked out life, right? Anybody agree with me on that? He had a crazy life growing up and then getting into his adult years. First, we see he was sold into slavery by his brothers. Now, anybody have any brothers in the room? A couple of you. How would you feel if your brothers decided to sell you into slavery? Pretty mad, right? Pretty upset. I'm sure the mood and the climate in that room would not be happy and joyful, go lucky, right? You'd want to rip somebody's throat out. He went from slavery to his brothers because they were jealous of him. Then a guy named Potiphar buys him, okay? And then his wife falsely accuses of poor Joseph of trying to take advantage of her. Then he was thrown into prison. And then all of a sudden after that, put in charge of Egypt. Put in charge. Went from being nobody to the big man. The man of the hour, the man of the time. In charge of everything. Now, throughout Joseph's story, God uses him to implement change. Awesome way. Let me set the scene for you here real quick before we get into it. Joseph is reunited, okay? He's reunited with his brothers and forgives them. I mean, that's just like off the wall nuts. He forgives them for what they did to him. He invites his entire family to move to Egypt from the land of Canaan, which in that day, it was a big family. It was a big thing. It was well over 100 people in the family. Now, who would love to be on a road trip with over 100 people? All traveling at once. Not in different cars, but like all walking together. How awesome would that be? Maybe we should try that one day. Just like walk to Rockford or something all together. How awesome would that be? Let's do it. So he had all of them move from Canaan down to where he was. Then he was reunited with his father. Soon after that takes place, his father passes away. And that moment right there sends an incredible tidal wave, sends a huge tidal wave of fear through Joseph's brothers. He had nobody. Joseph had nobody to hold him back from ripping their heads off. The brothers knew that their dad was dead, and Joseph, he was the man. He was the one in charge right now. He could do whatever he wanted to the brothers. So a tidal wave of fear went through them. It says this in Genesis 50, starting in verse 15. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrong we did to him? What if he comes at us? What if he comes at us and he tries to kill us and he wants us dead for what we did to him?" The climate, can you imagine the climate in that room and how full of tension and fear it must have been for them? But Joseph, where he was at, shows up quickly and shows how quickly the climate can change based on how we choose to react. Based on how he chose to react in that moment. Now Genesis 50, jump down to verse 19 through 21 says, "But Joseph said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done. The saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children.'" So he did the complete opposite of what the brothers were thinking at that time. Thinking, "Hey, we're done. We're dead. Our brother's going to kill us. What we did to him, we're dead. We're gone." But then he completely did a 360 on him. Totally rocked their world. Joseph allowed God to show his grace and forgiveness through the way he reacted and the way he treated his brothers. Joseph allowed God to help him react in the way that God wanted him to react. Instead of reacting based on past circumstances, past things that could have happened, that did happen. And we all have the ability to do the same. We can do the exact same thing Joseph did. You can be the person who brings peace to a stressful situation. You can be the person who brings joy to where a climate is sad or depressing. You can be the person who brings forgiveness to someone who probably doesn't deserve it, just like Joseph's brothers. How you react and how you treat people will not only show the love of God inside of you, but will show the love God has for them as well. So what are you doing in the climate you're in right now? The climate around you, the climate you see every day, your Monday through Sunday, your Sunday through Sunday, however your work week works out. What are you doing in the climate around you? And I'll use three examples for you guys today. The climate of your job, you could use the climate of your marriage, and you could use the climate of your family. I think every one of us are a part of at least one of those three. Which of these areas in your life God wanting to use you to change, to help implement a climate change in any one of those areas? Is it your job? God wants to use you and us to implement change in your workplace. Some of you are like, "Really? Have you seen my workplace? Have you been to my workplace? Do you know my boss? Do you know the people I work with?" No, I don't. But you do. So there you go. Perfect. The best way you can do that is by showing the same grace and love God gave you. Showing that to the people that you work with. People that you see, that you know a lot of dirt on probably, that you know everything that's going on with their life, you know their circumstances, you know their situations. No matter the situation, though, the way you react will set the temperature of not only how people view you, but how they view God as well. And I think if we hang on to that statement right there, we hang on to that sentence and kind of take that with us as we work. And because sometimes it's easy for us to be in a part of the climate that's already there, and then the other person who's being affected by it, because, I mean, this guy goes to church. This girl goes to church. And they act like that? That's how they act at church? I mean, I ain't going to go to that place. Forget that. I'm out. Peace. I'll see you later. I'll go to something else. How incredibly impactful can we be to people around us? And not just, like I said, not just showing us how people view us, but how people view God as well. Because they are looking, whether we see it or not, they are searching for something. They are seeking that, what we have, that joy, that passion, that excitement of what God is doing in us. If we don't show that, if we don't be a perfect example of what God is doing in us, they're going to see something completely different. And they're going to look at us and they're going to wonder, what is wrong? What is going on? Let me ask you this. How do you view the people you work with? Do you see them as obstacles you have to get around? Or do you see them as problems you have to deal with? Maybe you're not a boss, but maybe you have a coworker who's just all over the place. Maybe just makes a mess every time you work with him. And it's like, look at this problem. We gotta take care of it. Just make a mess, man. Just clean up after yourself. Come on, do something. Or whatever the problem may be that you encounter every day. It would have been so easy. Going back to Joseph, it would have been so easy for Joseph to view his brothers as problems that he had to take care of or deal with. I was like, what? Huge headaches. What am I going to do with these nuts? Why can't they do anything right? What they did to me, I'm going to get them back for it. They're dead. Guards, cut their heads off. How easy could that have been done? How easy could that have been? How easy is this for us to lash out somebody because of what they did to us? Or just how the climate is in general. But he allowed God to change his perspective. He allowed God access, full control of his thermostat, whether he was going to get boiling hot, ready to bust somebody up, or whether he was going to cool him down. Say, here's how we're going to go about this. Here's why we're going to do this. I'm going to guide you through it the whole way. Joseph didn't see them as problems. He saw them as needed forgiveness and grace. Number two, so your marriage. You guys are like, why is this guy talking about marriage up here? How old are you? I'll tell you later. I'm getting pretty old, so hey, it's getting there. But marriage, is it your marriage? Could it be? Could there be something? Could there be a climate difference, something that has changed maybe in the past year, maybe in the past few years? I get excited to talk about marriage. I love talking about marriage. Me and my wife are going to be married for 7 years next month. I'm excited about that. I love talking about coming up. You want to know what next month is? What month is it?
February.
You know what's in February? Yeah. Valentine's Day, the love month. So I get so excited when I get the opportunity to talk to our students, your students here, about marriage, about sex, about everything that's coming up in February. That's when I talk to them. So just giving you, if y'all freaking out about that, that's when I do talk to them about sex and marriage and all that good stuff. But I get excited about doing it. And it's good seeing and being able to pour into students who, yes, are not married yet, but when they get into it, they will see a reflection of what it's supposed to be like. Of a relationship that has God as the foundation. And not being told by social media or the world how a marriage should be or how it should look based on what Hollywood is saying. Get a little worked up about that. Sorry, we'll calm down. But your marriage could be red hot, not in the kinky way there. So calm down. Which means you or your spouse, maybe you fight a lot. Maybe there is just a lot of tension, and you just butt heads over everything. You go to bed angry. You get up in the morning and you just fight about the dumbest of things, the dumbest of topics or subjects. Or it could be ice cold. Which means there's no communication. Everything's cut off. Relationship has gone from being married to living with a roommate. Remember the story in the beginning of the roommates, my friend and the roommate? Crazy thing is about that, all along, the roommate had the opportunity He had the choice to change the climate in the room. He could have went up to his roommate, to the friend I was talking about, and said, hey man, can we work something out? Because I'm sweating to death, man, and my clothes are falling off of me. Or hey man, can we work something out? Please, we got to do something because my breath is coming. I can see my breath, and it's not supposed to happen when you're indoors. Can we work together as a team to make this right? To have a good climate we're in? He had the choice to do that. But instead of working as a team, working together, he chose to let the climate control him. Ladies, if you build your foundation of your marriage on your husband, because of how he makes you feel sometimes, or how handsome he is, or how good of a job he has, there will be times you will get let down. Fellas, if you build your foundation on your marriage on your wife because of how beautiful, how fine you think she is.
Amen.
We're talking. Or how she makes you feel. Or how good of a job she has. Fellas, we will get let down. Because there will be times because those things are only surface. Those are only surface, scratching the top of the surface. The foundation, the roots, the underneath part that we don't see a lot of your marriage needs to be built on something much deeper, on the foundation of the gospel of Jesus Christ that we read each and every day, the foundation of what we believe in being Christ followers, in following after Christ, and having a solid Christ foundation, and not letting anything get into that and crack the walls or break it down or tear them down, but being built and know what we are built on together as a team. Foundation needs to be built on something much deeper. Closer you both get to God, the closer God will bring you together as a team.
Amen.
The last one here. Is it your family? Parents, what climate are you setting for your kids? I think it's a pretty big question. Is it one full of pressure? Is it one full of tension or anger? Or is it a climate of love? Is it a climate of forgiveness or support? Parents, you and I are called to set the temperature of how our kids view life. Of how your kids view life. Because if we just let them go and do what society and the world is telling them that's okay to do, and here's how you got to grow up. You got to grow up looking at this stuff. You got to grow up listening to this stuff. Being a part of this group, being a part of that group. Because honestly, parents, whether we see it or not, whether we want to believe this or not, our kids are looking to us. Our kids are watching us. All the time. They might think they know more than you. They might even say it sometimes. You don't know nothing. I know more than you. Get out of here. They might say they don't want you to be a part of their life. But honestly, they do. Having the opportunity to work with students is one of the greatest things ever. That you've ever had the opportunity to do that. I know a lot of my leaders that help out will say the same thing. It is really cool being able to work with a student. Maybe they've come from a bad background. Maybe they've come from a broken home where they don't see how it is or how viewing life in a good, strong, founded, a God-founded relationship is supposed to be. But being able to go alongside them, to build them up and give them the support, the love and the kindness, and see how excited they get about that. And see how much they get out of that. And take home to the home that they go to, their parents, to their siblings. It's worth everything. It is totally worth it. Parents, I strongly encourage you, be a part of your kids' life as much as you can right now. If they're younger, perfect timing. Perfect timing. The, the younger the better. And then the older they're going to get out of the house and stuff. But as soon as you can, get a part of it. Like, be engaging with them. Do stuff with them. Because social media and the TV screens and the phone screens are taking over. Technology is going everywhere, guys. I read an article in a magazine about the next generation coming up called the Homelanders. That's the younger generation now. They're coming up now. They're calling them the Homelanders. You know, the Homelanders, what's that all about? They're homebodies. They don't want to talk to anybody. They won't talk to anybody. The way that they talk to somebody is through their phone. It's through social media. It's through text. It's through Instagram. It's through Snapchat. And that's how they have relationships. That's how they talk to people. That's how they do their jobs. When they interviewed kids, they said, I want to work from home. As long as I got my computers, I'm good. I'll work from home. I don't want to talk to anybody. I don't want to see anybody. And it'll blow your mind. I can show you this article if you want. It'll blow your mind how many hours is spent in front of a screen. 100 plus hours a week. One student on social media, on TV, binge watching a whole season, whole episode, all the seasons of one show in 1 week. 4 to 6 hours of video game play a day. Be engaging with your students. Be engaging. Don't let them just sit downstairs in front of the TV. Be a part. They want you to be, as much as they love the video games. Now listen, I'm not knocking video games. I love video games. They're cool. They're fun to play. I'm not knocking any of that stuff. But just be a part of your kid's life. Whether they show it or not, they want you to be a part. And they want to have fun with their dad and their mom. Show them what it's like. Show them what it's like to have a solid, founded, God-centered relationship. Because dads, moms, if you want them to be smart about dating, because it will happen. I mean, it's going to come up eventually. And all the dads in the room said, no, let's go. Right? If you want to be smart about dating, set an example of what a good relationship should look like before they even get to guys, before they even get to girls. Show them what it's supposed to look like. Because when you do, they're going to take that example. And they're going to know what you want, what a good relationship is supposed to be when they go looking for a husband or a wife. You set the temperature of your kids' lives. Even when they make dumb decisions, and it will happen, show them the grace that Joseph showed his brothers. Remember the story of Joseph and how much grace and love and forgiveness he showed his brothers. Best way we can change climate of our lives by allowing God to be shown through us. Because ultimately, God is the greatest example of changing climate. Before Jesus, we can read that the world was just full of hopelessness. It was full of condemnation. It was full of depression and sadness. But God decided to take the thermostat at that time and drastically change it. He changed it from empty, and he changed it to fulfilled. He changed the climate from being lost to the climate of being found. Changed it from hopeless to being forgiven. And he did all that by sending his son to die on the cross for us. I try every Wednesday, man, embedding that into our students. That what Christ did for us is not something we just read about in a book. This is something that through the help of what Jesus has done for us, we have the power, like I've said, to change the atmosphere that we are in, to change the climate of what is going on in the world around us. So if I could give you one challenge before you all get out of here, Tracy, you mind? I got you this time. I remember. You can be one to change climate, not to conform to it. Change it. Something's not right. You have the power. Turn to your neighbor and say, I got the power. Oh, come on. Y'all know that song. I've got the power. Come on. Turn to your other neighbor and say the same thing. We're gonna have to work on this. All right, I'm having a class down the hall and right after church. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. Change climate. Wherever you go, every one of us in here, I don't care how young you are, I don't care how old you are. I love what Pastor said in the beginning. And having generation and generation interact with each other. I think that is crucial to the younger, to the homelanders, to the millennials growing up now, getting older, and being able to see what God is doing through the older folks and how God can do the same thing through us, and how when we grow up, we don't make those mistakes that have happened through the older people, but we see how God can work in and through our lives. I encourage you, find a young person. Students, find an older person. Talk to them. See what it was like for them growing up. See how different it was. Your minds will be blown. Their minds will be blown by what's going on right now in our world. Ask them if they want to get on Snapchat with you. Older folks, ask them if they want to go out on lunch or breakfast. Well, maybe not breakfast because they're probably sleeping until noon. I'm just messing. See if you want to take them out. Just talk with them for a little bit. But be one to change climate. Don't conform to it. Father God, I thank you for what you've done in this place today. The lives and the hearts that have heard from you, God. The climates that are going to be changed this week, because of what you've said into our hearts, what you've shown us today. I pray that jobs, I pray that marriages, I pray that families have a climate that is full of your grace and your mercy, that is full of your presence.